Hi, good morning, good afternoon, good evening, whatever time it is. As always, happy whatever day it is you're watching this. Welcome to episode, I think it's 123 of Left Side of the Aisle. I'm your host, my name's Larry Erickson, and for the next half hour, I'm going to be your ranter and raconteur, talking about things important to me and that I think are worthy of your attention. Comments, questions, or reactions can, should be sent to me directly at Hooviating, Hooviating, at AOL.com, or you can go to my website, Lotus, Surviving a Dark Time, and you can leave a comment there, or you can get the email address from there. As always, whenever you email me, I ask just two things. One, that you be a little patient. I'm kind of slow about answering email, but I do answer it. You will get an answer. And two, be sure to include something in the subject line, like Left Side of the Aisle, your cable show, something obvious so I know it's not spam. All right, with those introductions, let's get to it. I'm going to be able to start, as I always like to start when I can, with some good news. Two bits of good news, in fact, both of which come from the Southwest U.S. First, we go to Arizona. Now, last year, Arizona passed a law which would prohibit Medicaid patients from receiving any covered services at any clinic that also provided abortion services. This law was clearly and directly aimed at Planned Parenthood. And, you know, it still strikes me, whenever I hear about one of these things, it still strikes me that Planned Parenthood is a controversial organization. Planned Parenthood? This just shows how far to the wacko right a number of our state legislatures have gone, that Planned Parenthood is a controversial group. But anyway, they passed this law. Well, Planned Parenthood and the ACLU sued. In February, a district court agreed, granting a summary judgment for a permanent injunction against the law. The good news now, the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals has just upheld that decision. Judge Marcia Berzin, writing for the unanimous three-judge panel of the Court of Appeals, said the issue comes down to a simple fact. Federal law allows those who receive Medicaid to get the services from any qualified provider. Now, the state made the absurd claim that, well, yeah, that's true, but the state is free to decide what the word qualified means. Which is really absurd, since the federal law defines qualified as, quote, a provider qualified to perform the service or services required. Now, the state has never claimed that the physicians and so on associated with Planned Parenthood are unqualified to perform gynecological exams or to do STD testing. And in fact, they told Planned Parenthood that they could continue to participate in the state Medicaid program if they stopped doing abortions. This claim about what if they're qualified, just, well, let's put it this way. The judge, in writing her decision, didn't actually say this, but the meaning came through clear enough. That defense was really lame. This is actually the second win for Planned Parenthood within a month. A similar law in Indiana, the end of July, got hit with a permanent injunction. This was the day after the state conceded in an agreement with Planned Parenthood of Indiana and Kentucky that the state can't violate the federal law's freedom of choice provisions. Now, Indiana, however, has not given up. First, you need to know of mifepristone. This was formerly called RU-486. It's the so-called abortion pill, the morning after pill. It's a non-surgical means of providing abortion in the first 7 to 9 weeks of pregnancy. Well, a new amendment to Indiana law requires that any facility which provides this medication must meet the same standards as clinics that provide surgical procedures, including separate procedure recovery and scrub rooms, even if no surgical procedures are performed at that clinic. This amendment, it turns out, applies to precisely one clinic in the entire state, a Planned Parenthood clinic in Lafayette, Indiana. But Planned Parenthood and the ACLU, they haven't given up either. They have filed suit saying the amendments, quote, are not reasonably related to any legitimate purpose. They irrationally and invidiously discriminate against Planned Parenthood and impose a significant and unnecessary burden on the women affected. So the fight does go on. The other bit of good news I've got revolves at the fact that something a little strange is going on in the state of New Mexico. Judge Alan Malott of New Mexico's 2nd Judicial District, this is state-level court, Judge Alan Malott ruled on August 26th that state law does not prohibit same-sex marriages and ordered the county clerk of Bernalillo County to start issuing marriage licenses to same-sex couples. This ruling came out of a lawsuit filed on behalf of three lesbian couples who said the state constitution has no explicit ban on same-sex marriages. In his ruling, Malott said, quote, "Gay and lesbian citizens of New Mexico have endured a long history of discrimination. Denial of the right to marry continues this unfortunate and intolerable pattern." He also, interestingly, refused to stay the execution of his order, finding, quote, "no benefit to the parties or the public in waiting for a lengthy path of litigation while basic rights, quote, are being compromised or denied on a daily basis." All right, so that's Bernalillo County. Meanwhile, just 4 days earlier, as a result of a lawsuit filed by two Santa Fe men, District Judge Sarah Singleton issued an order to the county clerk of Santa Fe County, New Mexico, to start issuing marriage licenses to same-sex couples. Again, she found that the law does not prohibit this. Earlier that same week, Doña Ana County Clerk Lynn Ellens began issuing licenses to same-sex couples after he said that state law doesn't prohibit it. So marriage justice appears to be spreading in New Mexico like county by county. Now, after the Doña Ana clerk began issuing the licenses, some Gopper lawmakers said that they were going to file suit because they said county clerks can't make law. Well, that's true, but of course, in this case, what's being argued is that the clerk isn't making law, he's refusing to enforce a law which doesn't exist. Meanwhile, neither Republican Governor Susana Martinez or Democratic Attorney General Gary King, who's planning on running for governor next year, seem inclined in any way to step into this discussion, which itself is a kind of good news, because how long ago was it that there was no question about a political cost of taking a position on same-sex marriage? All right, from one to the other, from the sublime to the ridiculous, if you will, we go to one of our regular weekly features, the Clown Award, given for meritorious stupidity. And to do this, we move out to the great state of Colorado. On August 21st, Colorado State Senator Vicki Marble suggested that high poverty rates among blacks and Hispanics are connected to diets including fried chicken and barbecue. After she declaring that she loves the barbecue chicken she had down south, she went on to say, quoting, "The Mexican diet in Mexico, with all of the fresh vegetables, you go down there, they're much thinner than they are up here. They change their diet. I've read studies on that. Those things aren't good for you," she added. Oh yeah, them Mexicans and them blacks, they loves them some fried chicken and barbecue, don't they? What really made this stand out for its bigoted stupidity is that she said this during a meeting of the state legislature's Economic Opportunity Poverty Reduction Task Force, which is aimed at least hypothetically, of finding ways to reduce poverty by increasing economic opportunities for the poor. Committee members at this time were being presented with statistics about racial and ethnic disparities in poverty, and she decided to make it about fried chicken. Now, on the upside of this, another committee member later said that there was an audible gasp in the room when she said this, and she got immediate pushback from other members, one of whom called it racist and insensitive. But, apparently wanting to nail down her claim to the Clown Award, Marble later released a statement saying, quote, "My comments were not meant to be disparaging to any community. I am saddened they were taken in that regard." In other words, I didn't do anything wrong. I'm just sad that you couldn't understand, which makes me the sad, misunderstood victim here. The Denver Post wasn't taken in. In an editorial, they called her original remarks finger-licking stupid. And of her later statement about how sad she was, said, "We're saddened that a state lawmaker can be this ignorant in 2013. Yeah, ignorant and a clown. All right, from there, I haven't talked much you probably realized about the monstrous policies and practices of the NSA in spying on Americans' phone calls, email, and internet use, nor on how the Obama gang has aided, abetted, advanced, and covered up for the spooks. I haven't done this largely because there's been so much information about it, so much coverage of it. There's been so many revelations, more revelations than anybody can actually keep up with. So many so fast that for the first time since 9/11, a majority of Americans are saying that privacy concerns outweigh fighting terrorism. The truth, I'm certain you've heard about this. And while you may not know all the details, you at least know the general thrust of the story. But there was one bit I do have to tell you about. It's the outrage of the week. Just over a week ago, President Obama announced he intended to arrange for the creation of an independent group of outside experts to assess and review the nation's intelligence gathering and surveillance technologies and programs. And who has he picked to establish this group, to give it legal existence? Who is the person who will help to, in the words of the amazing Mr. O, maintain the trust of the people that there is no abuse? Why, it's Director of National Intelligence James Clapper, the man who outright lied to Congress, the man who outright denied that the NSA collected any information on Americans, the man who outright lied to Congress about it, and who, when he was caught out, claimed he had, quoting, responded in what I thought was the most truthful or least untruthful manner. Which, of course, was another lie, because the most truthful answer would have been, yes, we do spy on Americans on American soil. Because the fact is, you did it, and you do it, and you do it on a mind-bogglingly massive scale. But no. He later insisted to Andrea Mitchell, no, the agency doesn't collect information about Americans. And he could say that because he told her he had his own definition of the word collection. No matter how much information the agency gathers, how much it stores, how much it collates, how much it organizes, no matter how much information they soak up, none of that, according to him, has been collected. Not until some individual agent actually sits down and actually looks at a specific record. Oh, well, that makes it all better, doesn't it? The NSA was quick to emphasize that Clapper will not be in charge of this group. He won't even be on the group. And the members will be picked by the White House, they say. Apparently, this we're supposed to think this is going to happen without Clapper's input. No, he'll merely consult with the group and assist it when it needs access to classified information or security clearances. In other words, the man who lied to Congress about what was going on is the person who is going to control the access to classified information that this group is going to need. And that may take on even more importance when you consider that Clapper's own statement about the establishment of this group refers to national security, advancing our foreign policy, and the risk of unauthorized disclosure, but doesn't mention anything about abuses. Now, the whole spying business itself, obviously, is an enormous outrage, an enormous affront. But to have James Clapper anywhere near any group that's supposed to review the whole apparatus of spying with any hope of, in Obama's words, maintaining the trust of the people that there is no abuse, is an outrage within an outrage. And it's offensive to boot. We're going to take a break. And we're back. Now, I'm actually recording this show on August 28th, which is the 50th anniversary of the 1963 March on Washington for Jobs and Freedom, the march that featured Martin Luther King's famous I Have a Dream speech. This past Saturday, August 24th, tens of thousands of people, in fact, about 100,000 people, based on a comparison of the size of this march with the one in 1963, about 100,000 people gathered in Washington, D.C. to remember that march and that speech and to ask how far we've come toward reaching that dream. The only possible answer, the only legitimate answer, is partway, only partway. The numbers tell the story, at least they're part of it, a story of mixed results. So the rates of poverty and unemployment among blacks remain nearly double that of the overall rate. Part of the reason for that is that blacks continue to get paid less than whites. In 2011, the median wage for black women was $13.13 an hour. For black men, it was $14.26. For white women, $15.89. For white men, $19.76. Despite that, the overall income gap has actually shrunk. The median income for African-American families today is still an embarrassingly low. It's only like two-thirds of the overall national median. But that's up from 1963, when it was only half of the national median. However, despite that narrowing income gap, the gap in the rate of home ownership has actually grown since 1963. Whites still live longer than blacks. Again, the gap has shrunk from 6.5 to 8 years longer to 3.5 to 5 years longer. The gap in infant mortality rates between whites and non-whites has actually grown since 1963. But at the same time, the overall rate has dropped so far that the rate among non-whites is a quarter of what it was in 1963. And the current rate among non-whites is about half of what the rate was among whites in 1963. As compared to 1963, the percentage of blacks who have completed high school has more than tripled. The number of black undergraduates is now more than 10 times what it was then, and the percentage who have completed at least 4 years of college is nearly 6 times what it was then. So yes, there have been gains in some ways. Yes, it is better than it was. Yes, we have made some progress in at least some ways toward that dream of measuring somebody by the content of their character. But having progressed does not mean having arrived. Martin Luther King III, MLK's oldest son, said it well at the march on Saturday, quoting him, "This is not the time for nostalgic commemoration, nor is this the time for self-congratulatory celebration. The task is not done, the journey is not complete. We can and we must do more." And that's really true, especially when you consider the part of the story that the numbers don't tell. And I don't even necessarily mean big things like the Trayvon Martin case. No, I mean the little things, the everyday slaps and slams, the everyday reminders that if you are African American, in the eyes of too many, you are still other. Examples such as the family that went to have a going away party at a restaurant in Charleston, South Carolina recently, and after waiting 2 hours to get in, was told almost immediately by the manager that they had to leave because one white woman in the restaurant found them threatening. Or maybe you prefer more aggressive slaps, such as that delivered to University of Texas student Brian Davis on August 21st. He was struck by a bleach-filled balloon while he was walking in a neighborhood populated by University of Texas students. This is another in a string of bleach balloon attacks, all of them aimed at Asian or black students stretching back to last summer. Yes. Things have improved, at least in some ways. Yes, we have made at least some progress, painfully slow progress when we bear in mind we're talking about 50 years here. But yes, there has been some progress. But again, advancing does not mean arriving. Improvement does not mean cure. Progress is not a cause for passivity. We have to keep on keeping on. We have to keep on being, as I've called on people before here to be, steely-eyed dreamers. People who know the hard work that is to be done, but who never forget the dream that that work is on behalf of. A dream that can be brought down, in my view, this whole dream can be brought down to a single word. Justice. Now, as a footnote to all this, I have to mention one thing. One area where we can see genuine progress over these years. The chief organizer of the 1963 March on Washington was Bayard Rustin, an African American. He was also a mentor to King. He helped found both the Southern Christian Leadership Conference and the A. Philip Randolph Institute. But at the time of 1963 March, his part in organizing it was played down, even kind of concealed. Because in addition to being an unbowing advocate for civil rights, who was significantly responsible for introducing Gandhian nonviolence to the civil rights movement, Bayard Rustin was gay. And in 1963, that was something better left unsaid. And all this talk now, the rest of the show, just talk about something else. For all this talk now about the march and whatnot, I have to admit it got me thinking about the 60s. Because the March on Washington was, in a lot of ways that we don't seem to recognize, was actually a spark. It was a foundation for what we think of as the 60s, which really started about 1963 and went to about 1972. And I'm thinking that, you know, there are some ways in which I miss the 60s. Now, you got to understand, I'm not talking about nostalgia. I don't want to go back to the 60s, okay? There are a lot of things wrong in the 60s. I mean, for one thing, we have some technology now that, I'm not big on high tech or the most latest and most advanced technologies, but, you know, we have technologies that I like that weren't available in the 60s, and I wouldn't want to just give those up easily. There was actually, as we just talked about, there was more bigotry. It was worse in the 60s than it is now. Crime was actually a bigger issue in the 60s than it is now. I mean, have we forgotten about Richard Nixon running as the law and order president? Infant mortality rate was higher. The poverty rate was higher. And we tend to forget there was a war, a big war. You know, I have a notion that the time at which people come to what I call political maturity, what's going on at that time affects their view of the world. It influences their view of the world. And I came to political maturity at a time that, you know, a possibly mythological time, marked at one end by the Sgt. Pepper summer and the other by Altamont, or if you prefer a political description, flower power in the days of rage. But people now, in the last couple of decades, you know, who have come to maturity during the Afghanistan war, during the Iraq war, I think some of them actually don't realize, when we talk about Vietnam, what we're talking about. The total number of American soldiers killed in Iraq and Afghanistan combined was 6,000 and something. The number of American soldiers killed in the Indochina War was over 50,000. Peak troop strength in Iraq was 140,000. In Vietnam, it was 540,000. It was a massive war. We didn't measure the deaths by one here and one there and two there. We measured them by 300 a week. I have no desire to go back to that. I have no desire to go back to this, to go back to the 60s, but I do have a desire to that some aspects of the 60s could be brought forward to the 20-teens. So one thing that I miss about the 1960s is color. Think of any cliche image about the 60s that you can imagine, and I'm willing to bet that one aspect of that image was lots of color. I miss that. I miss the explosions of colors and the poster art with like Peter Max, for example, the poster art with the very bold, dramatic colors. I miss being surrounded by color. Another thing I miss is the sense that music could matter. That's not, you know, not that all the music of the 60s mattered. In fact, there was a lot of schlock that was produced in the 60s. You know, sometimes you hear these shows about the lost 45s, and you hear some of those songs, and you're going, oh, that should have stayed lost, man. Remember Lori? Last night at the dance, I met Lori. Remember that? Do you remember The Race Is On by Jack Jones? Oh, these are, wow. And this also doesn't mean there isn't good music being produced now. It doesn't even mean there aren't protest songs being produced now. I just saw something recently about the top 10 protest songs of the 21st century. But the 60s had a sense. It was just a sense that the music could matter. That music could make a difference. That music could change the world. I mean, admittedly, that was over the top, but that was that sense that we had. Music could change the world. Music was more important to us. Music wasn't just entertainment. It wasn't just the way that some people made a living. Music mattered. The other thing that I miss, and this is the real point here, I miss that sense of solidarity. We were, back in the 60s, we talked about the movement. And it went in all kinds of different ways, all kinds of different subjects, all kinds of different topics, all kinds of different tactics. But the point is, we all thought, this is one movement. We are all part of it. Where I grew up, we had a military base, Fort Monmouth, New Jersey. And we used to have picket lines there on occasion, like, you know, maybe 10 people. That didn't matter. We were the same as the 150,000 who were out in San Francisco. And what's more, we were the same as the United Farm Workers. We were the same as the striking teachers. It was all the same thing. And that's something I don't see now. We look at, I talked about the Solidarity Sing-Along in Wisconsin. And this is great. It's wonderful. It's a great thing. And people support that and endorse it. But we don't feel that's us. That's them doing that. It's not us. It's separate. Every battle is separate. Every battle is a local battle that we don't perceive emotionally as part of the whole thing. This is one of the reasons, by the way, that the Occupy movement had to be destroyed. Because the Occupy movement, when it talked about the 99%, it says, hit that nerve. We are in this together. We are all linked, and all of our different struggles do relate to each other. Two reasons the Occupy movement had to be destroyed. One, it was in your face. It was in your face. You couldn't ignore it. It was always there. The other reason, though, was the fact that all of these Occupy sites, they thought of themselves as Occupy. Whether you're in Boston or New York or Oshkosh or wherever, you know, you weren't Oshkosh with Occupy. You were Oshkosh Occupy. You were all part of the same thing. There was a solidarity there that I have not seen otherwise. And I really, really miss that. We need to be back on the streets, because what we need, the one thing, those big marches that people say, oh, that's passe, that's old-fashioned, and all that stuff, well, nonsense, because the thing that those marches did is they gave you that sense of solidarity. They gave you that sense that this is all one thing. We are all linked. We are all part of the same thing. We need to be back on the streets. And I don't mean just once. I mean over and over and over again. No, this is not something that's going to be done this year or the year after. This is year after year after year after year. We have to be out on the streets, locally and nationally, to say we are all one movement. We are all one consideration. And that one consideration is, again, justice. All right, I'm going to finish with that. I'm just going to finish up with our regular weekly reminder. As of August 27th, there have been at least 7,616 people killed in this country by guns since Newtown, at least 79 of them in Massachusetts. That's it. You have the best week you possibly can. I will see you next week with hopefully more good news.